I'm Megan Woodward-Post. I'm from the city of Seattle. I'm a process engineer for the ITSM team, IT service management team. I'm here with a couple of my colleagues. One of them's recording in the back. One of them's right here in the second row. I might be bringing them up a little later to answer some questions if we've got some questions. But I'm gonna tell you a little bit about myself first. I'm a little bit of a storyteller, just to kind of give you a little bit of a warning. So before I came to the city of Seattle, I've been telling a lot of folks here that I used to plan conferences just like this. And this is actually the first time I've ever attended a conference as an attendee. And I used to book speakers just like me. And I used to beg them to come up on stage and talk about stuff and just think about everything that goes into making a conference. But beyond that, the other thing I used to do in hospitality is I did project management. And I was kind of the type B that Sam Rad talked about yesterday, the generalist that would get assigned the stuff and go figure it out. Okie dokie. And so my first foray into asset management was our company got bought out by another company. You might figure out what this company is as I'm telling this story. And so the job was, hey, we've got all of this signage at 70 plus resorts all across the country, and it all has to be rebranded. So could you just figure out all the different signs that need to be replaced? Take the pictures of each and every one, figure out the materials that are gonna be needed to replace each and every one, and whether or not we need to rewrite every single one. So yeah, that was a lot of fun. And it was me and a camera. So it was definitely low tech, and trying to figure out, you know, we had no existing inventory of those signs. So it was a good lesson in, man, we should have thought of that at some point. This story will make sense as I'm going along a little later. But so kind of the when I came to IT, what I brought with me was, yeah, okay, that was crazy and a lot of work. And we need to figure out better ways of managing a lot of information besides going out and taking pictures and sending somebody out to each and everything. And we can't do that every year or every 2 years or every 3 years. All of that is very expensive. And certainly I work in the public sector, so the amount of money we have to do that kind of stuff is zero. So I'm here to talk to you about our journey, meaning the city of Seattle's journey, specifically my team's journey. I love to talk about my team and the journey we've had in ITSM, but more specifically, our journey in asset management, how we've worked to develop relationships between our assets, and how we're working towards data governance, which is super important. So, in thinking about today's presentation, I told my boss, this needs to be the most epic presentation ever. So I started thinking about The Lord of the Rings, because it's epic. I know, I'm kind of a geek. And I could tell you about the forests and the valleys and the treacherous lava plains and the mountain passes we travailed. And then I could pack my wizarding stick and my cloak and my beard and come as Gandalf, right? Present this case. I think you guys would have dug that, but that also seemed like a lot of effort. So instead, I just made this PowerPoint, and it's still kind of movie themed, but you know, we'll get some funny stuff along the way. But today we will actually be talking about some stuff, and so we're gonna talk a little bit about how the city of Seattle organized our Ivanti asset management module implementation, how the city addressed its biggest challenges in implementation, and how we always have to remind ourselves why we're doing it, It's not only for ourselves, it's also for clients. So we have to think about why are we collecting this information? Is it going to be important to our clients? And our clients are not only, well, our clients in Seattle, City of Seattle IT is actually everybody else who works at the city, right? So we can't forget them. Why do they care about us managing their assets? So it's a very important part. And then we'll talk a little bit about our current state where we're at right now with ITAM. Full disclosure, we're not done. So you'll learn that as we get through this, but it'll be very apparent why we're not done. And I think it's an important story to share in terms of here's some pitfalls you can avoid to maybe get closer to being done. And here are some things that we've learned along the way. So, of course, all epic journeys begin with a beginning. I mean, that's kind of self-evident, right? But when Ivanti asset management module was purchased in 2020, the city of Seattle was tracking some assets, mainly just computers, right, in Ivanti CMDB. In order to support the over 50 city departments and various major assets, various work groups were launched to now try to take all of the other assets into our system, right? Because all we had was computers, and we still had to move computers from the CMDB into the ITAM. And so we had to consider, is all the information we have in the CMDB relevant? And how is that going to be valid? And how do we need to use it in the future, right? Each work group focused on its individual asset, right? And, oh, sorry. And the data and the governance needed to manage that asset moving forward. So, for instance, because we work in the public sector, we have criminal justice information, CJIS data, we have NERC data, which is what belongs to Seattle City Light. We have PII, PCI. We have all the acronyms you could probably think of, even HIPAA. And so we have to think about one, there's data we can't mix. It has to be stored a specific way and applies to specific compliance rules. There has to be assets that are managed a different way because they belong to Seattle police officers versus somebody who works in the art department. So those are all things that we had to make sure we had subject matter experts who had been doing this work, supporting those assets for years. So that was where we started, right? Was gathering our subject matter experts. And that is really important. You have to know who those people are and really be able to sell your story of why you need them. So, what are our challenges? This will kind of give you a glimpse at our challenges. Centralizing this CMDB of an enormous amount of assets, right? 21,500 workstations, including desktops, laptops, and tablets, 15,000 mobile phones, 1,600 network devices, 3,500 virtual and physical servers, over 2,200 applications that we know of. I should make that point, and 6,300 active databases. And all of these, of course, as I'm sure you probably already gathered, are all living in disparate sources, right? Every team has had their separate application that they've been using to monitor their databases or monitor their servers or monitor the network. And so they're storing that data for their specific type of work. But we're all in our little silos, having our little data that we're not sharing with each other. So the ongoing battle for being the source of truth is a real thing at our city. We're still having it, actually, right now. Each with their own special needs and processes. Everybody wants to do it their way. On top of that, Seattle IT as we know it right now, meaning as a separate department that exists with 650 people, has only been a department for 7 years. Before that, there was a department called the Department of IT, but it was just infrastructure and a help desk. And there was then every single department, so the bigger departments had their own internal IT department. And so we consolidated in 2017. And so that also makes this a more complicated scenario because everybody came with their own history of, well, I used to work for Seattle City Light and Seattle City Light did it this way. Or I used to work for Parks and Parks did it that way. And so you kind of just have to be like, okay, well, that was 7 years ago or 5 years ago. Now we're in IT, one team. But it, you know, it's still a common thing that we're hearing all the time. So we have to sell this story that one source of truth means something. And why does it mean something to each person, each team, each asset? Why does that matter for the purpose of doing our work? So we're going to go through that. We're going to talk about increasing visibility and efficiency. At the beginning of the asset management cycle, we put in an approval functionality, which for the first time ever provided visibility to the management of the actual cost of assets as a portion of their staff overhead cost. People were just buying laptops. Had no idea how much they were spending on those laptops. Had no idea even what the life cycle of those laptops were. So adding just one simple step of an approval in there and saying, hey, here's your laptop information. Here's an approval about that laptop information. Here's how long that laptop's gonna last you. Here's when you're gonna have to budget again. Just provides so much visibility and importance to that manager about what their overhead cost is going to be. Additionally, we have audits. So we're audited. And audits become more precise and efficient because we have more data that's there and available to be used by the audits that are done either by city, state, city budget office, lots of different folks who are trying to audit and make sure that we are correctly using our funds for what we're saying we're using them for, which is super important, obviously, to the residents of the city of Seattle. Obviously. And finally, the big selling point I feel like for service providers was establishing and maintaining relationships between major assets provides a lot of benefits for people who are servicing tickets, including enhanced response and recovery for disruptions or emergencies. For example, it's going to be easier to identify any interconnected applications and databases hosted on a server that is experiencing an outage during an incident, right? So if you know a given server has these given applications and also has this database all interconnected to it, and you can see that one of them is disrupted, you can probably functionally then understand, well, perhaps these other items are going to be affected as well, and it's going to increase your response time. So selling that story to people who may not traditionally love transparency in ticketing systems or service management systems like server teams or networking teams, is really important. You've got to figure out what story is going to be the one that's going to make sense to me, to them, right? Tracing incidents overall has been a long issue for us. So, for instance, today we talk a lot in the city of Seattle about the hot potato. Does any of you know that term? Do you guys have the hot potato? Okay. All right. So the hot potato are incidences that just bounce around from person to person to person until somebody decides, I guess this might be mine, until you go back and you look at that incident and you'll see eight or nine tasks attached to that one incident because you'll just see reassign, 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 reassign. Because really, these people are not able to see that they are the root cause, right? Or they don't want to own that they are the root cause. It's one or the other. And so we hope as we build these relationships that we're able to say, hey, guess what? We just proved it to you. You're the root cause. You need to own this because look, this is where the problem's at. It's not this application over here, even though you keep assigning it to this application team. It's the server over here, right? We just had a change on that server. It's impacting everything else. So I think that's where those relationships are, again, really important to selling that story to the people that you want to use asset management. And it's a hard story to sell because it is a lot of work to collect that data and get people to be excited, just like you all were super excited about hearing asset management, about asset management at 3:30 in the afternoon. That's how excited people are to even talk about it when they're at work. You know, it's even less exciting. So focusing also on the data, the where, the what, the how, and the why, right? As I was mentioning before, our tools are very siloed. Many of our tools are necessary for the operational work of those teams. So, for instance, our server team has SolarWinds. So that tool is necessary for server monitoring, right? Our desktop team has SCCM and LandSweeper. Those tools are necessary for their work, right? But the information they have on those tools isn't always the same information that we're going to need to consume for asset management relationships because they're using it for different reasons, right? And so it makes sense for us to consume the data from them. Because they already have a lot of the information that we don't really want to duplicate, like about that server or about those desktops. But some information may not make so much sense. We'll talk about that a little bit more as I go on here, but you just have to really be have some discernment about what data is coming from where, because is it all good? No, I'm going to tell you right now, it's not all good. It's just the honest truth. Just because it's data doesn't mean it's valid or important to what you're trying to do. Okay? So, as an example, I'll talk about my personal horror story. So, when our second asset was applications. Now, I wish I could turn back time and say, man, we probably shouldn't have picked applications as our second asset to bring in. Because you're thinking to yourself, all these other disparate systems probably have application information on them. And you're right. The SCCM, LandSweeper, SolarWinds, they all have application data. And guess what? None of that application data matches the data that we already brought in about applications because it's different, it's for a different need, right? So does that matter? It's a different, maybe the application has a different name, right? That might be the variance. And so then you're in your world of, okay, do I need to focus exclusively on the name doesn't match? Is it still the same application? Is there some other way I can relate these two items? Because I need that other information and I need to know that this application is sitting on that server. So it's not always about the more information you have, it's always better, right? It's kind of thinking about what information is absolutely the most important for right now. Okay. Once we knew, like, where we're bringing the data from, how are we bringing that data in? Again, I'll say it was what data and why, right? And absolutely plan for a lot of times to have these, a lot of time to have these conversations because they're super lengthy conversations because you will sit there and argue for days about what data and why. Because everybody thinks their data is the most important and the most valid. Okay. But back to my application story, too much of a good thing is too much of a good thing, right? My colleague who's sitting there in the second row, he's laughing because he knows we brought in all this application data, and then we realized, wow, we really don't have the maturity in our organization to keep this data up to date. We thought everybody would think this was just cool to have all these data fields, know all this stuff about applications, but guess what? They just sat empty. So when you're trying to get people to use a new tool, hey, look at our nifty application portfolio and all these empty fields. It's not really conducive to having people want to use it if fields are not being used, data is incorrect, people stop updating it. So it's really like, what, again, what is the most important thing for your organization? It's to know that there's an application. Here's the owner of this application. Here's the department that can use it. I could go on down the list of 20 or 30, maybe 40 fields that are absolutely necessary for our application portfolio. And we probably had hundreds to start out with, right? And so now we're in the job of scaling back. So I say, don't replicate that mistake, folks, right? Start early and say, what are we really going to use? What is really important? What is really valid? Because all that other stuff is just noise that people aren't going to care about. They're not going to update. So then it's just going to look like garbage, right? And who wants garbage data? Absolutely no one. So, all right. So, talking still, true. Data is the most important thing because why? Asset management really is mostly about data. So here is where the conflict occurs, right? What is the system of record? What are the sources of truth? Who will own the data? We are still arguing about that today, by the way. Who owns the data? Nobody wants to own it ever. The reality is, everybody's like, it's that guy over there. I'm sorry if I'm pointing at you, person, but it's always somebody else. Nobody ever really wants to own any data, even their own data. They'll say, this data is really important to me. Oh, but I don't own it and I don't want to update it. Okay. Sounds good. What assets will be linked via relationship? So this is a good discussion point too, because do all the relationships matter? Asset to server might matter, but does server to network matter? I don't know. Does application to database matter? How many databases do you have? Are they all within the applications, or are they separate? What impacts do these relationships have over time? So how often are you going to have to change those relationships? Because they're going to have to be managed just like any other piece of data. Even something that's a discovery tool, right? It's just going to give you, we think this is related, and you're still going to have to figure out, are those really related the way that this discovery tool is telling me they're related? So I think it's beneficial to think out, we have always, you know, sorry, let me step back a second. It's always important to think out what relationships are going to be the most important for your customers, what relationships are going to be more important for your service providers. We have struggled defining a consumer of data versus source of data, right? So who is going to consume this? Who is going to be the source? We have to favor adoption and overall accuracy, which means sometimes ITAM must be a consumer. So what I mean by that is precisely the example I was giving you before, right? So in our SolarWinds example, we are a consumer of SolarWinds data. We are not a source of truth. In application information, we are a source of truth. Other people are probably going to consume our data. So it's important to understand where you're going to be a consumer of data and where you're going to be a source of truth, and define that early on and really have that agreement from everybody who's participating in the project, so that you avoid this conflict. Because trust me, like I said, we're still having this conflict because we didn't have the conversation earlier on. So I will tell you that, you know, there wasn't any epic battle scenes during our conflict. There wasn't any wizards or orcs or anyone else. And no animals or people were harmed during any of our battle scenes. Yet. So, you know, there's still time. No worries. So one of my specialties in my team is focusing on clients. That's why I joined the team. I like to tell stories to clients to help them understand what's in it for them, right? And part of OCM, organizational change management, is helping them understand the why. And I just attended a session, Taj, it was a good session. And he reminded me of that as well, really helping people understand that why. So we have internal clients, our own service providers in the IT department, and we have our external clients, those folks in the city, other city departments, right? So for our internal clients, it's that ability to see links between assets when high priority incidents or problems are identified, right? That's going to be really important for our problem solvers. Having a centralized repository to see data and get streamlined reporting. Streamlined reporting. I'm a data analyst, so if somebody tells me that magical two words, I'm like, yes, streamlined reporting. As opposed to approaching every individual team, because this is what people are doing, and asking them for their individualized spreadsheet or information for data on servers or mobile phones or databases or anything else, right? We can be a centralized place for most consumers of data to get that information. External clients provide, again, that greater transparency to the cost of items. Oops, sorry. Provide transparency to the ownership of items, especially staff designated items such as computers and mobile phones. Okay. We have a lot of situations where, you know, we have folks who just end up with a different laptop than they originally signed. I ended up with a different mobile phone than I was originally assigned because they never turned it back in when they left the somebody never turned it back in when they left the city. Pretty much, right? Somebody else just inherited it. Provide better information about applications available across the city to avoid purchasing of duplicate applications. So this is still the bane of my existence, unfortunately. It's really hard to get people to not duplicate applications when you have 2,500 applications and 50 city departments and each individual team or person or random thing wants their special function covered. And even if you tell them there's five other whiteboarding collaborative tools that we already have at the city, they'll say, but this one has that one special feature where you can highlight the letter Z every time you use the letter Z. How important is that really? Come on, it's the letter Z. Does that really matter? I mean, no, I mean, I'm being funny, but it's really that silly, right? Where people just focus so specifically on features that it's very hard to get folks to stop duplicating the same type of applications. But it's something we're working towards because we're spending a lot of money on subscription applications. And then, of course, our centralized repository provides a lot of opportunity for automation. One of the first things that we did as we started bringing on our assets is said, hey, if we have a service request where people are needing true real-time computer information or real-time server information or real-time database information, let's use that asset information we pulled in and use it in our service request. Use it to improve the function of that service request. Make sure we're assigning somebody directly to the database that they're asking access for. Make sure they're reporting a problem on the actual server that they're having an issue on. Make sure we're, automating things that we are able to do where, one of the things I'm particularly proud of is we designed an RO that has web services where folks can come in and pick an application from the drop-down list, and there's all the data for that application. If they know anything about that application, they can go in and update the data. They hit submit. That web service just flies away and updates that application record, right? So those are the benefits of things that you can do once you start getting that data is, wow, this gives us opportunity to do something great in the system with this data. So now we're gonna be real here and talk about our progress. This is where I was saying, yeah, we're not done. Right? This is our honesty moment here where I say, we're not done. So think of as we moved right to left on this graph, or I guess it would be, yeah, you're right to left. So think of phase 0.5 to 1 as just starting levels 2 and 3 there. Are meeting and gathering data. 4 is built, but may have some items still pending. 5.5, which is our lonely application row there, the gray one. It may always live forever in 5.5 because it'll never truly be done. We can call this built, but in the process of modernizing, always. And then 6 would be in a static completed state, which is really only going to exist for things that can remain pretty stable, like printers and workstations, right? Maybe your servers. So maybe there will be some other assets as we get up there that'll maintain that 6. But things like that are a moving target, some of the newer hardware out there, devices out there are going to probably be forever at that 5.5, like my sad little application bar. You could also think of 0.5 as being in the Shire. Six as being, you just threw the ring in the fires of Mordor. And three, you might be Gandalf and you just came back to life, or you were rescued by the Ents. So, anyways, I love my Lord of the Rings. All right, so what's next? Improving, adding, and building, right? We're going to continue to improve our data import methods. If we're currently using ETL to bring in data about an asset, can we switch that to an API? Can we switch that to some other mode of bringing in that data? We're still adding in more assets. So as that chart showed you, we're still adding some new things in. We're just decided to start bringing in mobile devices. And we're bringing in telecom circuits. So you might be asking why we waited so long on mobile devices. And that's really just back to that story about siloed teams, right? Where mobile devices have kind of moved around in terms of who was managing them. And largely, mobile devices at the city are managed by people we call telephone coordinators, and they live in each department. And they manage those mobile devices for that department. So we're trying to at least know how many mobile devices are even out there from a theory of just how many, and maybe help those telephone coordinators a little bit in doing those jobs. So building links, how do we show flat relationships, right? And again, how do we keep those up to date? Okay, so wrapping up. What should we take away from our journey? Start planning early with outreach to subject matter experts and stakeholders from each asset area to gain alignment. Frequent meetings with ongoing agendas and deadlines for any needed work from other teams. My colleague Dan is excellent at that, by the way. Visual representation of data flows should be created as needed when using data federation. So what I was talking about before, if you're bringing in data from SolarWinds, you should be creating visual representations of how that data is going to flow in or out of your system. Anytime data is going to go somewhere, in or out, make it a visual. Make sure that clients and project members understand the why. Okay? Organizational change, best practices should be adhered to as you venture on your own journeys. I cannot say it enough. Organizational change management, OCM, thanks. Have sponsors, perhaps multiple if you need them. Make an actual stakeholder list so it's clear that you understand each and every person's needs. So those stakeholders could be your SMEs too, because they're your stakeholders as well. Don't be afraid of those people who ask why. I'm terrified of people who ask why, honestly, during process improvement efforts. But you really shouldn't be afraid of them. I struggle with them, but they just need extra help understanding why the change is happening. So create a story that resonates with them and keep going until it actually resonates with them.